YouTube, it's Tone, back with another one for you. So this one here, what you're gonna see is this is a continuation of the Redemption Manual. This is video number 12 on this, and we're gonna get into the different types of currency in the next couple videos here, so you get an understanding about what the fiat currency system is like, how it works, and how you have every right to go ahead and create a currency just as well as any of these other private financial institutions, which your all cap straw name is a financial institution just as well. That's how they're able to create debt using your straw man, is because it is a financial institution. The only thing is that they're using it fraudulently and they're hoping that you don't catch that. They can't use your trade name to create debt without your authorization. That shit is fraud. So we're gonna get into that. We're gonna get into the different types of currency right here. Let's get this started. So commodity money. Commodity money is the oldest form and has its roots in the barter system. As each ancient society evolved, there has always been a few items that were more commonly used in barter than other commodities. This is because they had certain characteristics which made them attractive to almost everyone. Eventually, these items were traded in large measure because they represented a storehouse of value, which could be exchanged at a later time for something else. At this point, they ceased bartering and became money. They had become a medium of exchange. Since the medium of exchange was a commodity with intrinsic value, it is called commodity money. Commodity examples of commodity money, all common examples of commodity money include ornaments, colored seashells, unusual stones, cattle, sheep, corn, wheat, and other foods. Eventually, when a man learned how to refine metals and craft them into tools, the metals themselves became valuable. Initially, these metals were traded as commodity money due to their intrinsic value. Intrinsic value means something that has a value other than what it is used for. So if, you know, a piece of paper represents a piece of metal, then it has intrinsic value because it's worth more than just the paper itself, because it could be redeemed for a piece of metal, right? So that's what the gold would represent, is it could be cashed in for a piece of gold. So it's useful for something other than that. So, but when they had additional characteristics that made them very desirable as money, it was not perishable, it was portable, and it could be precisely measured. Money in its fundamental form and function needs to be a storehouse and measure of value. In this way, it is the measure of which all the other things of value can be measured. The ability to precisely assess metals in purity and weight makes it ideally suited for this function. Men on every continent and throughout history have chosen metals for the ideal storehouse and measure of value. Gold is one metal that has been selected by centuries of trial and error to represent this. Now, they've been, you know, they purposely manipulated the value of the different metals and things like that. So if you look at the periodic table, you'll notice that silver comes before gold, which means that silver is more valuable than gold because you need silver to make gold. Okay, so that's how you know that they've been messing with the value of the different metals by playing fucking stupid games like that. But that's because America sits on the biggest storehouse of silver in the fucking world, and we are the richest fucking people in the world. If you were born here, you're entitled to all the mineral values and things of that nature that are on your land. Okay, so this is why they want you to think that gold is more valuable, so that way they can run that. But silver is obviously more valuable, because without silver you wouldn't have gold. Really that simple. Okay, so let's go ahead and get into the next slide. So the storehouse and measure of value. Silver has run a close second to gold throughout history. There seems to be enough gold in the world to keep its value high enough for useful coinage. Gold is less abundant than silver, but more abundant than platinum. And it is a commodity in great demand and purposes other than money. It is sought for both industry and ornamental purposes, which assures its intrinsic value. The purity and weight of gold can be measured precisely. So gold meets each of the requirements for money. So some might argue that gold is inappropriate as money because there is too little of it in the world, that's all fucking lies anyway, in the world to satisfy all the needs of modern commerce. We would suggest that this is not the case. It is estimated that approximately 45% of all the gold mined since the discovery of the so-called America is in various vaults of the many social constructs known as the government, right? Government means to mind control. Government. So money and man, a survey of monetary experience, Elgin, Grow Close, page 259. It would be reasonable to estimate that 30% can be found in jewelry, ornaments, and private hoards. So it would be hard to argue that it's 75% of the gold found since Mr. Christopher Columbus is available that is too rare to serve as money. We would also suggest that the amount of gold in the world does not affect its ability to serve as money. It only affects the quantity used to measure any given transaction. Governments could easily mint gold coins in almost any size to create smaller value. Using gold or any other metal to serve as money virtually guarantees the stability of the commodity money system. This is true because there is a fixed amount of it in existence, which is a lie. We live in a land of fucking abundance and there is no limits to anything. Okay? Know that. So when the quantity of so-called money expands without a corresponding increase in goods, it affects a reduction of the purchasing power of each monetary unit. In other words, the quoted price, the price as expressed in terms of monetary units of goods increase, the real price in terms of relationship to all other goods remain the same. This is what we call inflation. The price of goods does not go up, but rather the value of the money goes down. To illustrate this point, let's look at some price and wage statistics in 1913. The Federal Reserve Act was passed. The average annual wage in so-called America was $633. The average exchange value for gold that year was $20.67 per ounce. This meant that the average worker earned the equivalent of 30.6 ounces of gold each year. In 1990, the average annual wage was $20,468. But the average rate of exchange gold had gone up since then, $386.90 per ounce. The average worker therefore earned the equivalent of 50.9 ounces of gold per year. This is an increase in wages measured in gold of only 73%, while the increase in dollars was 3,233%. The 73% increase represented less than 1% over the year period. So while this happened, there has also been a steady increase in purchasing power. About 1%. Let's see what this is. A year that has resulted in gradual improvements due to technology. This improvement in technology is the real reason for the improvement in the standard of living over the last 100 years. Now we'll get into receipt money. The development of receipt paper came as a result of necessity. When a man accumulated more coins than he required for daily purchases, he needed a safe place to store, warehouse them. So the goldsmiths filled this need, since they usually had vaults to store the gold they used to create to repair jewelry for their customers. When customers stored their gold coins, they were given a receipt that entitled the owner to withdraw their gold at any time. Eventually, it was common for owners to endorse his receipt for a third party who, upon presenting the receipt, could withdraw the gold. These endorsed receipts were the forerunners for our modern checks. The final development stage occurred when several smaller receipts were issued rather than one, with each imprinted, paid to bearer upon demand. It became increasingly common for these paper receipts to be used as money of account. So you see that receipt as money of account was fully backed up by a commodity gold coins that had intrinsic value in the money of exchange. So what they're saying is that so people used to keep all of their gold with the jewelers because they had the safes. So rather than carrying around large bags of gold, they would have the jeweler issue a safekeeping receipt for them to indicate the amount of gold that they had inside the vault, and then they could at that point fractionalize the dollar value on the paper that they gave them representing the gold that was inside of the safe, and they could issue those paper notes to people, and they could go to the jeweler and collect that gold whenever they wanted to. So the paper essentially became the money, but it was represented by gold, or backed by gold, and then they could go collect the gold at any point that they wanted to. That's not the system that we use now. So we'll get into the fiat money. So fiat money is money which is declared legal tender but is not backed up by anything, such as gold or silver. Its two characteristics are that it is not backed up by anything of intrinsic value. It is decree legal tender. Legal tender means the so-called government issues a law requiring everyone to accept the currency in commerce, since the money really is worthless. Since the money really is worthless, and it is fucking worthless, It only has value because you think it does. But we'll get into this here right now. Since the money is really worthless, the so-called governments can get it accepted by forcing the people to do so, often under criminal penalties. Their own Federal Reserve notes are fiat money. If you read this article, what banks don't want you to know, you will know how we got this condition in so-called America. Interestingly enough, the Massachusetts colony was only the second government in history in the world to issue fiat currency, China being the first. Shortly after the currency was released, the state experienced 1,000% inflation. Other colonies quickly followed the Massachusetts example with similar results. Connecticut had inflation of 800%, and the Carolinas had 900% inflation. In the beginning of the Revolutionary War, the total fiat money supply was $12 million. In 5 years' time, an additional $425 million had been printed. This means that the money supply had expanded 3,500%, and the original continental dollar was trading at less than a penny's worth of its original value. There is a typical pattern that emerges when fiat currency is used. The government artificially expands the money supply through the issuance of more fiat currency. This is followed with legal tender laws to force acceptance of the fiat currency. Next, all the gold and silver disappears into private hoards, or it is paid to foreign traders who insist on real money of exchange for their wares. Often, the inflation is high. The government will have to issue new bills valued at multiples of the old bills. This usually leads to discontent and civil disobedience through barter. The last stage of each cycle is rampant inflation and economic chaos. Fiat money is used by so-called governments to obtain instant purchasing powers for themselves without increasing taxes, but it is not without cost. Some complain that we should not burden anyone's children with anyone's future public debt. It is true that all children will have to pay the burden of the interest payments on the debt, but there is also a very real initial cost that all pay. The cost is paid by all the people in the present through a decline in our purchasing power. It is exactly the same as a tax, but one that is hidden from our general cognitive view simply because the purchasing power generally is not affected in any great dramatic decrease to raise any perceptible cognitive awareness of the dilemma that we collectively face by the issue use of fiat currency. So this is a quick little overview of what the fiat currency system is like. I mean, this shit goes on and on. So in the next video, you're going to see more examples of different types of currency and their effects on the population whenever they decide to go ahead and issue different types of currency other than something with an intrinsic value backed by something tangible like silver or gold and things like that. So, you know, the more you know is the better that you're going to be able to do. So let's get into this next slide here. I thought that shit was done. So here's the last slide on this. So fiat currency. So what the majority of this country failed to realize is this: because of the bankruptcy and having been pledged an asset to the national government's debt, this makes all citizens debtors. But you're not a citizen, and you need to know that too as well. You know what I'm saying? So it makes all the citizens debtors. Your all caps name is the debtor, but you're not the fucking all caps name. That's the thing. So under Chapter 11, debtors in bankruptcy have lost their solvency, have no rights, have no standing in law, and are at the mercy of the creditors via their attorneys. All courts today sit and operate as non-constitutional, non-Article 3 legislative tribunals administering the bankruptcy via their statutes, codes. And that's what I already told you, too. They're all just fucking administrative representatives for the bankruptcy, for the reorganization of the American corporation, essentially. So all courts are Title 11 bankruptcy courts, where these statutes are in reality commercial obligations being applied for the benefit or privilege of discharging debts with limited liability of the Federal Reserve monopoly, colorable money, Federal Reserve notes, debt instruments. This means every time you end up before a court, not only do you not have any standing in law to state a claim upon which relief can be granted, you have no constitutional rights. Why? Because you are a debtor under the bankruptcy, and in addition to having contracted away your rights in exchange for benefits and privileges, you do not have one single shred of evidence to establish otherwise. Remember, if you do not know and stand up for your rights, then you do not have any. The initial SPC filing helps to do exactly this, as well as create a separation between the debtor and the secured party. And that's exactly what the fuck that does. So in bankruptcy, only creditors have rights. In a nutshell, as a debtor, you have no rights. Rights are reduced to mere privileges, which are licensed, regulated, and can be altered, amended, and changed to meet whatever in particular or special needs of the government may be for whatever whim. If taking away your home, car, taxing your labor, locking you up, violating any of your 60 million plus legislatively created debtor codes and statutes they have on the books today happens to meet the need of the government, it really doesn't take a rocket scientist to see who the loser will be. And so that's what it is, you know what I'm saying? So that's how crucial it is to get your paperwork in there, get that done, state your primary lien holder position on the all caps name, commercially capture that motherfucker, and these people cannot just use it whenever the fuck that they want. So it is a game of chess. Stop playing checkers with these assholes. That's what I got for you for now, until we meet again.